Hello there, and welcome back to the Chap's Guide. Now this afternoon, I'd like to talk to you about an icon of style and a person who quite literally has changed the way that we dress and quite frankly, the way men thought about dressing a generation or two ago. And that's the Duke of Windsor, or as he's also known, King Edward VIII, because following a life as the Prince of Wales, and, you know, let's be honest, he was quite an extravagant playboy who enjoyed life to the very fullest of its extremities. He acceded to the throne of the United Kingdom and became king upon his father's death in 1936. And he walked away from all that. You know, he held the best, most prestigious title on the planet. King of the United Kingdom and the British Empire and its dominions. Emperor of India. Quite a remarkable, you know, the British Empire was at its absolute zenith, but he walked away from that to go into exile with a woman that he loved because he was not able to marry Wallace Simpson, the American divorcee, who he wanted to spend the rest of his life with. And hence, walked away probably one of the most stylish men that the world has ever known.
A few hours ago, I discharged my last duty as king and emperor. And now that I have been succeeded by my brother, the Duke of York, my first words must be to declare my allegiance to him. This I do with all my heart. You must believe me when I tell you that I have found it impossible to carry the heavy burden of responsibility and to discharge my duties as king as I would wish to do without the help and support of the woman I love.
Now, Prince Edward, or King Edward, or the Prince of Wales, or David, as he was actually known to his family. David, Duke of Windsor, was a man who, I think it's fair to say, had a very willful nature. As you could see if you looked at the earlier parts of his life, where, you know, he clearly abhorred royal protocol. He had very little time, totally impatient for the sort of the conventions and the trappings of royalty. You know, a gilded cage in which he was trapped for that period of his life. When he was Prince of Wales, he held court in his home called Fort Belvedere in the grounds, or certainly on the estate of Windsor Castle, where there were many lavish parties. And he, you know, undertook this lifestyle of this remarkable royal playboy, heir to the imperial throne of the British Empire. And that willful nature could be seen in the way he lived his life. You know, he lived to the excesses of the time. He had many affairs with married women and, you know, showed no sign of settling down and conforming to the social rules and protocols of the 20s and 30s when he was leading this life on the cutting edge of style. Now, following his abdication after only 11 months as king, he went into exile and eventually, taking the title of Duke of Windsor, then went on to lead his life in various parts of the world. So he lived for a time with his bride in the Caribbean, where he was governor of the Bahamas. But then he returned to a more regimented life in Paris, where he spent the majority of his later life with the Duchess of Windsor, and they became socialites of the highest order. Now, of course, there were no such things as, you know, the celebrities, this culture that we've become accustomed to in the modern era. But the Duke of Windsor was perhaps the first of the media celebrities who were, you know, in the tabloids, utterly at the attention of the media and the press throughout the remainder of their lives, always, you know, being reported upon wherever they went, what they were seen dressing. And from his younger days, David embraced style. You know, from the way he dressed, you could tell that he took a lot of interest in the clothes that he wore, the styles that he set, and you know, just the way he dressed every day to make an impact upon society and the people around him. But more importantly, he dressed for himself. He wasn't somebody who conformed to the dressing standards that would have been expected of that era. Because back then, men's fashion was incredibly stiff. It was incredibly formal. Men would have, you know, clearly worn strollers when they walked around the place. They would have worn court dress, but not for David, Duke of Windsor. He broke many traditions. He broke the style rules time and time again, to the point that the way he dressed has been now, you know, taken on his name in many respects. You know, the Windsor tie knot, named after him, became something which he brought forward. Dressing in sort of tuxedos or dinner jackets instead of formal evening dress was something which he spearheaded. Because as a royal, you know, rules were there for him to be broken. And he broke those rules. He set new styles. He set many of us free from the conventions which would have been imposed upon men's dress way back in that period. And as I say, he wasn't afraid to break with tradition. And he could often be seen wearing livid colours, bright patterns, geometric patterns. You know, he dressed in a way that would have been outside the expectation for a man of his station and actually for his stature. He was a relatively small man, quite lean. And in fact, you know, a remarkable thing is his body shape hardly changed at all in his life. He died in his 70s. And he more or less was the same size as he was as a young man. So he kept himself in shape, which meant he had the benefit of a lifetime's accumulated wardrobe to choose from as well. So he gave us some really good ideas and tips. But he dressed, you know, he wore bold patterns, which would, you know, essentially be a no-no for a man of relatively small stature, because it makes you look smaller. But he did that, you know, he stepped outside the conventions. And he left us with some things that we can learn from the way that he dressed day to day. And here are just five of the tips which we can draw from the Duke of Windsor's style. Now, the first one is invest in your clothes, because with the proper care, the proper attention, they can last a lifetime. We know that when the Duke of Windsor died and his estate was sold on, his chattels of his accumulated life, many elements of his wardrobe were things that he had bought many, many years ago. And that's because he was able to invest in good quality clothing that would stand the test of time, that wouldn't go out of fashion, that was well put together, so that meant it lasted a long time as well. So that's the first tip that he left us with. Spend as much as you can afford on those signature pieces that you know are going to be an important part in your wardrobe, because by doing that, they will last a long time, and they're things that you can call upon for the duration of your lifetime, or certainly the duration that you'll fit into them. And that was a good little tip he gave us, you know, stay in shape so that you can make the most of that wardrobe you're investing in. The second tip he gave us, and one very close to my heart, is that the cravat is cool. Now, I did a video all about cravats a little while ago. I love wearing cravats. I'm actually not wearing one today because it's a really quite warm day, and I didn't think to throw one on. But he often wore a cravat and paired it with things that you wouldn't expect to be worn with a cravat or an ascot. So for instance, he often wore a cravat with a polo shirt, which is perhaps not really the way you would expect to dress today. You certainly wouldn't pair something which you would perceive to be, you know, modestly formal like a cravat with something which we consider to be informal like a polo shirt. But the Duke did. He pulled it off, and I think he made cravats cool. And gentlemen, chaps, we can make cravats cool again. We just have to wear them. And the third tip he left us with was, you can break the rules. You can wear bold checks. You can wear patterns. Rules are there to be broken, particularly in style. They're not written down. You can't get arrested if you wear garish or livid colours or whatever style rule you perceive to be holding you back. Sometimes the rules can be broken. And if you break them, you can make a fashion statement that can be a signature statement for the rest of your life. However, tip number four for me that the Duke left us is, don't try to be too nonconformist all the time. There are times, much as in the Duke's life, where he wore what was expected for the occasion. And when you get an invitation to go to an evening party or something like that, and it says, you know, dinner jacket, don't think that means you can dress in some outlandish dinner jacket because you think you're showing panache and an avant-garde style. Because when you turn up and you're the only person dressed in that fashion, it can be a total bummer for the party and it can make you stand out as a bit of a fool. So, know when to be nonconformist and know when to dress in the style which is appropriate, and then you won't be a clown. And finally, the last tip, and possibly the most important one, that the Duke of Windsor left us in his long style life was, whatever style you chose to make your own, be that smart, be that casual, or somewhere in between, own it. Own that style and commit to it. You know, don't wear half something garish and half something, you know, formal, because you feel a little bit, you know, uncomfortable or lacking in confidence in fully committing to that stylish look. If you're gonna do it, own that look, take it on board, wear it, and wear it with confidence and wear it in a way that's gonna make you stand out. Because, you know, half having the confidence to wear something, it shows. It shows that you haven't quite committed to it. The Duke told us that, you know, sometimes he was seen wearing a piece of string holding his trousers up. You know, I know you could say, well, he could get away with it. He was a Duke. Nobody cares about, you know, protocol and who's a Duke and things like that these days. But it's all about the way that you carry style off. And the Duke was able to make style his own because he owned it, he wore it, and he wore it with confidence. And in his case, it would be a lot worse than yours, because he knew that whatever he wore would be photographed, would be in the papers, it would be picked apart by the columnists. For us, if you wear something that doesn't work because you're trying it, well, it'll be forgotten about next week. Worst case scenario, your friends rib you about that shirt or that green velvet dinner jacket that you wore in the weeks and months to come. It's not the end of the world. You're not going to be judged by it. So please, if you decide to set a statement with your fashion sense, own it, wear it, make it your own. So chaps, I hope you've enjoyed this trot to an icon of mine, the Duke of Windsor, or King Edward VIII, or David, however you want to call him, because I think he's left us with a really strong legacy in the way that we dress and the way that we approach style for chaps. If you have enjoyed this video, do me the good favour of clicking that thumbs up button to show me that you've enjoyed it. And when you're there, click the subscribe button as well so you don't miss any of our future material. Because it's not just about style icons, we talk about men's fashion, we talk about self-development, and we talk about grooming as well. So get on board with the Chaps Guide, join us on your journey to Chap Nirvana. I look forward to seeing you again very soon. Until then, please take care, look after yourselves. Goodbye, chaps.